What's up, everybody? Once again, it's Brand Man Sean, and we got to go over four types of deals that every artist should know. And this question was inspired by one of the questions in the comments. They were asking about record deals versus distribution deals. We're going to get into all of that. As a matter of fact, starting with number one, distribution deals, one of the more popular deals that you are hearing about today. So what exactly is a distribution deal? Well, let's just talk about distributing your music, getting it out there through different channels. That's Apple Music, Spotify, Target, the radio. Those are different routes of getting your music out there. So what distribution deals really handle is really getting your music out there, right? And helping promote that music. When you think about a distribution deal, traditionally, it's also known as a P&D, pressing and distribution deal. So if you can recall back in them days where people really, really listened to CDs, they were pressing CDs, distributing those out to the retail stores. Well, now we have digital. So even though you can use TuneCore and some of these other people to distribute your music, that's why they're called distributors. These distribution deals still entail those, but you still get the benefits of retail and radio, like I mentioned before. But it can also cover additional types of promotion, right? Like posters and even videos of some sorts. Now, what are the cons of distribution deals? If you're somebody who's looking for a lot of money up front, distribution deals rarely have money for you up front. There is no cash advance, which means a distribution deal is pretty much useless to somebody who does not already have some sense of an established fan base and also a well-planned strategy to promote that music and get it out to that fan base. Now, there are quite a few artists who are signing distribution deals earlier, and you know, the landscape is changing, so I'm not saying it's completely 100% useless for you, but it's not going to be a game changer like you might think. Not immediately, at least. Now, number two, the traditional record deals. The traditional major label deals that so many artists think about and so many artists have dreamed about are actually broken down like this. One, you oftentimes do not maintain your masters. Two, you are given a nice cash advance and they try to boost your presence up out of the gate, but you don't really see those kind of deals these days with the artist that is, you know, just straight from the dirt. But with all that being said, they give you all that money. They want that money back. That money is not yours to have. It is a loan. Major labels, in terms of these deals, should be looked at as a bank. They want their money back, and that's why they get some royalties. That's why they also look to have masters oftentimes, so they can use that as a bit of an insurance, just in case maybe even your immediate royalties doesn't bring them the money they want. It's musical real estate. Number three, the production deal. Now, this is you being signed by a producer if you're an artist. So what you see oftentimes in this kind of agreement is a major label or a label of some sort gives a producer a deal for them to develop artists under an umbrella. So if you're a producer and you know you got skills and you have a good eye for talent and people really have faith that you can develop this talent and make some hits with them, that's what these deals are for. Now, when you think about it from an artist's perspective, what I've heard or even just seen online in blogs and things like that is it's pretty common to have a 50-50 split between the producer. But with that being said, the money that gets made is at first a 50-50 split between the producer's company and the label. So let's just say there's $100, the label gets $50, and then the producer's company is distributed another $50, and then you and that producer might split that $50 into 25-25. But of course, it's really going to depend on what gets negotiated between you and the producer, what that split looks like. And there's occasions when that producer or whoever that company owner is in that sort of deal might also own the masters. That can be wholly or partially, once again, up to negotiation. Now for number four, we're talking 360 deals. Y'all have heard quite a bit about 360 deals, so I'm not going to go super deep into them, but it's once again that idea that the label also gets to profit from pretty much every place that you profit from. Not just music sales, album sales, you know, all that good stuff, your merch, your touring, I don't know, maybe even TV appearances, all that good stuff. A lot of artists do not like that, especially older artists, because they weren't used to hearing something like that. What? I'm making all this money. I can't believe that record labels are stealing from these new artists by taking this other money that we never had to pay them. That's cool. I get it. But just to bring a little bit of logic into that situation, It was really created in a time when record labels were having a hard time finding how to make money because the music industry was changing dramatically at that time. So in some ways, it was just risk insurance. I'm not saying you should sign up 360 deals, but from a business standpoint, there are some things that I can understand, especially if the artist has no buzz whatsoever, particularly within that time period. I think 360 deals will continue to evolve, actually not evolve, really kind of go extinct, because as the industry evolves and people are coming up with more innovative ways, right, these boutique labels, these marketing labels, all these other types of business models, is not going to be as necessary. And just to be frank, it's had a bad rep. 360 deals have a bad brand. So even if people would like to get a 360 deal, they might not, just because there's a negative connotation and they feel like they shouldn't. So they're just gonna have to rebrand the product, just like they did with those variable rate mortgages that kind of helped cause the recession. But anyway, that's a whole nother conversation. If you like this video, go ahead and hit the like button. If you like it, might as well share it. And if you're not subscribed, you know what to do. Hit that subscribe button.